Sorry for that. So as I was mentioning, this is a Composer workflow session. We'll be briefly seeing on what is Composer for those who have not done Composer and how you can use Composer in your project. And then even if you have done a D8.7 or lower version projects that doesn't use Composer, how you can get them migrated into Composer workflow. So the latest one. And there is a D8 startup workflow I prefer using, like at least in my organization, I help the team use that with certain tweaks. I'll just show how we do that as well. And I'm Gobinath Mallaiyan. I work for an organization called Tata Consultancy Service. Some of you might have heard about it, some of you might not. And we work with many companies, like, you know, there are a lot of clients with us. We do Drupal for many of them. And as I was mentioning, you know, like I know a thing or two about Composer workflow. You know, may not be, I may not be the guru of it, but I think I'm somewhere there to help others get on board with Composer. And if you're looking to find me on the internet, pretty much you can find me at GobinathM anywhere, like Drupal.org, Twitter, or Slack, Drupal.org, Slack, everywhere. So, and as I was mentioning, what we are going to look at today is that first the basics of Composer. You know, some of you might not be using Composer at all. So for you to get on board, what is Composer, to get that basic idea, we'll just look at that part. And then Drupal 8, when Drupal 8 started, we started using semantic versioning. When you use Composer, semantic versioning is another key thing to understand, that one. And as I was mentioning, you know, we are going to look at how to migrate a non-Composer managed project to Composer managed. And then other two items will be pretty much like a demo, how to patch and how to improve your Composer workflow. So if none of you have any questions, I can move on to the topic. If you have anything to ask before I get into the topic.
Do you have URL for slides? Or?
Yeah, I'll be uploading them into the Camp website itself. Oh. So you'll be able to download it from there. So what is Composer? Composer is like a command line utility. You know, there are various command line utilities, right? So for those who are working in Drupal for quite a while, you might know that there is Drush for managing any Drupal functionalities, like clearing the cache or installing a module or doing any sort of things, like even performing an upgrade, all those things you used to do it with Drush. Now with D8, we got into Symfony. When we got into Symfony, we use Composer-based workflow. Why do we use Composer-based workflow? It's because most of the modern PHP applications use Composer-based workflow. Why is it beneficial? So the first and foremost, why it is beneficial is that, see, most of your dependencies or libraries, you can load them into your Composer, Composer file, where they get managed or installed for you when you run certain commands. So we'll be seeing those commands later. But it's like you don't need to carry all the baggages with you anymore. Baggages in the sense, in D7, some of you might have used Drush Make to install the application. Some of you might have, what you might have done is, you might have installed everything in your local and committed the whole code base into your repository. When it comes to Composer, there are times where you just need two files, composer.json and composer.log. Apart from that, you don't really need to commit anything, because when you run certain commands, your site is going to get generated. That's why we use Composer. And you know, like, as I said, patching, all these things can be managed with help of Composer. So many things which you might have struggled, it's not that everybody would be facing that struggle. Some of you might have faced struggles in the past that can be simplified using Composer. It's not just Drupal that uses Composer. Many PHP modern applications like Laravel, Symfony, other framework, Cake, PHP, whichever you take, most of them do use Composer nowadays to manage their dependencies. And then, I know, it's not just Drupal module you can define in your Composer. You can even define JavaScript libraries. So like in your project, you may want to use D3 library, JavaScript library, just as an example. Maybe you are doing some charting or something in your admin screens. For that, you need D3. So installing the D3 can be part of your Composer workflow. So what does that mean is any kind of dependency which you need for your project can be managed by your Composer. And, you know, as I state here, like Composer is pretty much heavily inspired by NPM. Most of you might be using NPM, right? Like for all the node package manager, like for all the JavaScript dependencies. So it's strongly inspired by that. And when we started D8, Composer was part of it. So people started using Composer. Whoever had a better understanding of Composer, they were using it right from that day. And in the core, we do support it, but it's not like 100% Composer workflow was not available with the Drupal core till now. With the release of Drupal 8.8, we do have a 100% support of the Composer workflow within our Drupal project itself. So now if you get into drupal.org, you'll be able to find information about what to do for setting up your site using Composer. When you use Composer, right, like most of you, if you are working in Drupal for a long time, what you would have done is you would have gone to drupal.org/project/Drupal to download a zip file and then start installing your application. But going forward, you will not even be doing that. It will be a simple command from Composer to run it in your command line for creating a project. So I'm talking about Composer so much, but there are some key components of a Composer-based project. First one is Composer JSON. So what is Composer JSON? Composer JSON is nothing but as the name suggests, it's a a JSON file where all your metadata gets stored. I'm not sure if it is readable. So it's a Composer JSON file. You know, you can define pretty much all your dependencies, libraries, whatever you want in this JSON file. Some newbies, they always have a question, do I need to create this file manually? So that's not necessary. You don't need to create them manually. You can simply run commands to get the file generated. Like for example, if you get onto a folder and simply just do Composer init, it will create your base JSON file. So how do you get Composer init to run first? First of all, you need to install Composer in your machine. For installing Composer in your machine, so there is this getcomposer.org. So if you go to getcomposer.org, there are different installation instructions for Unix, you know, Mac and Windows, pretty much all the platform what you will be using, you can get them installed. And since you are already working on Drupal, you might be having PHP, whichever version you have. So it's pretty straightforward installing Composer. When installing Composer, you get to do it in two flavors, either install Composer locally or globally. What does locally or globally means? Locally is nothing but installing Composer just for the project you are working on. So within the scope of your folder, like you have a project folder, just try to install Composer within that folder. That's what is installing Composer locally means. Installing Composer globally means installing system wide. So it can be accessed not just by this one project you are going to work on. Tomorrow, if you're working in a different project, you will be able to use Composer in that project as well. So any number of projects you want to use, all the projects you will be able to use Composer if you install them globally.
Now, is that like on your machine or is that on the server?
It's on your machine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And the Composer workflow, as I was mentioning, when you start development, you're going to develop in your local, right? So first step, you need to have it locally. And then if you're using platforms like Acquia, Pantheon, or Platform SH, some of them provide Composer support directly in their platform. You don't need to do anything extra, directly run Composer on their platform. Like for example, Platform SH, in your Platform SH YAML file, you just mention that it is a Composer type project. So it asks what type of application it is. You mentioned Composer. So immediately when it starts building, what it does is it looks for the Composer JSON within your project root. If it finds the composer.json, simply it runs Composer install. And it builds the whole dependency and everything. A whole bundle gets installed within your application, whatever is needed. So that's why, first it is local and then in your remote server. If you are going to use a CI/CD or something, then you need it on the continuous integration server as well. So for building the project. And when you install them, most of these packages get installed to a directory called vendor. You might get a question, where does my Drupal core get installed? Drupal core, we do follow a slight bit of a configuration, how and where to install. In the extra section, if you don't mention this, what happens is that it goes by default. Since Drupal core, in Drupal core 8, everything is under web, it will start installing as web. If you want it to be customized for your need, like for example, the file I have up here, I was just testing with Acquia. So Acquia, everything is doc root. If there is no doc root, your site will not come up. Even if you install it in another directory, you may need to create a symlink. So instead of going through a pain of installing it in a different directory and creating a symlink, I'm just customizing my installer path to doc root itself to avoid the hassle of creating a symlink. And if you look at it, everything I have customized. I say Drupal core where it needs to be installed. So if you look at it, docroot/core, and the type is Drupal core, the Drupal core type will get installed in that directory. And then my contrib modules, I want it to be streamlined where my contrib module goes. So I have a folder contrib/the name. Name, the reason why I have it in a curly braces is that it's dynamic. So every time I install a new project, it's going to go in the folder called contrib inside that. Same way for the theme, and if I have a profile, and then I do have other other folders like custom. The reason why I have those folders is that if I do a custom development, like for example a theme I'm doing a custom development, or a module I'm doing a custom development, I want to segregate them from my community versions. Most of you might be doing that already, but here we do it dynamically. We don't need to manually create that folder. Composer will do that for us. Same way, I was mentioning earlier, you can manage like D3 library as an example I was giving. So for such libraries, I'm just using a folder library, Drupal library, bower assert, npm assert. So if you look at slightly up here, I had, some of these listed here. So I mentioned type library here. So anything I have mentioned it as a type library, that will be leveraging the path what I have set up, below there.
Gobi, how do you manage if you're running a multi-site?
So multi-site, pretty much with the extra, we can configure how we want to structure our information. So you will start installing the additional modules in a different folder.
Right, okay.
And if you have a custom module specifically for your multi-site, we may need to use something called script, Composer script, to properly manage that. So one of that which we will be seeing today is how I'm managing my custom modules to be installed within the folder. So like your custom modules, you can have it as a private repository or something and pull it during your Composer installer. Or you can keep it within this repo in a different format and pull it in. So I'll be showing how I do that as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then, nowadays we use different versions of PHP, right? Old versions are going away and new versions are coming in. So if you mention your PHP requirement, you know, either you can mention it in require like this, or there is a platform config, like in config, you can mention it here. So both are same, up in the requirement or here, both are same, no big difference. You just mention which version of PHP you want to use. The reason why you are going to mention which version of PHP you are going to use is that when Composer runs the installer, what it will do is for every package, it's going to check the supported version and it will download the appropriate version. So if you just don't set up this platform, it might download the latest version, and the latest version may not even work in your server. So like your server, you might be using PHP 7.1 and the latest version may not support PHP 7.1. It might, like, there's no backward compatibility. It supports from 7.2. What will happen is that you will end up getting the latest version, which will not run in your, meaning it might throw some errors in your platform. So that's why it's better to mention the PHP version. So Composer downloads the appropriate version on your dependencies, whatever you need. And then there are a few other configurations which we need to ensure in our JSON. Preferred installer, DIST is nothing but distributable. So instead of installing an unstable version, we want a distributable version, which is nothing but a stable version. We prefer that. And then, you know, discard changes, any changes you made locally, it will ignore, locally in the sense, you can have a Composer managed dependency in your local, and then you made some edits to that. Now, when you say discard, what will happen is that your local change will get discarded. Is that a good approach? It's not. But is it a good approach to even edit a third-party library? No, that's also not a good approach. You need to patch that library rather than directly editing the file. Because later point of time, that library might have a security vulnerability. If you end up editing it, eventually it will be a management nightmare. How you're going to manage it. So if you have it as a patch, it might be slightly easy to manage compared to directly simply editing and keeping it. And bin directory, most of your commands like drush, like for example, if you install drush using Composer, and what will happen is that the executable will get installed in the bin directory. So when you enter the bin folder, you will be able to see all kinds of installers, like executables. In this, you can see that whatever I have used, right, pretty much PHP unit, PHP stan, CS, CBF, all those kind of installers, like I have used them as my dependency in the project. So all the executables are available within the bin folder. I can get into the build folder and run those commands going forward. That means PHP CS, just as an example, you don't need to install system wide. You can just have it within your project if you need it. If you don't need it, you don't need it. And not sure how many of you are aware of this. Like for example, Drush 9, there is no global installer anymore. It has to be project based. And if you want to run it from anywhere else, there's only one option. There is a supplement project called Drush Launcher. You just install that. So it just helps you run from anywhere. But installing can be done only locally to the project. So, yep.
Can you walk me through again where I find these composer.json files in a Drupal installation?
It'll be in your project root. Okay. So if it's a old project like D7, if you have downloaded as a zip, then you will have it in the doc root or vendor web folder.
The JSON, Composer JSON you just showed, is not a standard Drupal one. You've modified it, right?
Yes.
Now, if I pull in a standard Drupal D8, 8.8 site,
right,
and I want to modify the composer JSON to change where things go, like you put Docker instead of web, how does that affect what I've already done with composer? Will it repile stuff?
No. If you already have your docroot or web set up in your server, if you want to change it, then you need to make those server updates as well. Where is your docroot? All those things you need to update if you are going to change it.
Yeah, because I'm thinking in certain places, instead of a docroot, there's just public HTML. I want to put Drupal 8 there. Right now it goes to public HTML/web, which doesn't work for the Apache installation, and it's hard to change the Apache. It's weird, but if I could change the composer and then reinstall it, it goes to public
HTML, yes.
So you just install it, then reinstall it after you change.
Yeah, just composer install will bring do the reinstallation.
Okay.
So for example, as I was mentioning, how I help my organization do this, we don't even care about what is there in docroot, vendor, and bin directory. So that is not in our repo. And when we do composer install, the first thing we try to do is delete these three folders and then reinstall it.
Okay.
So that get rid, we get rid of whatever we have there, we do a fresh install. Our server is always configured to docroot. When we do composer install, the docroot folder is present,
yeah,
where the core index.php file is also present.
Okay.
So if you have configured your server to public HTML/web, you can delete it and redo, delete the anything inside public HTML, change your composer file and install it there. But when you do it, you need to reconfigure Apache so that your docroot is understood.
It's already configured.
Yeah.
Go to public HTML. It's hard. I didn't understand how to get it to go to the right place. Now that shows me how.
Yes.
Thank you.
No problem. And composer JSON, as I was mentioning, when you simply run composer init, once you have composer in your local, when you run composer init, you're going to get a vanilla composer file created. After that, you can add whatever dependencies you want. You have two options. Either you can run a command to add those dependencies, or you can simply add it manually. When you add it manually, the problem is, you need to ensure all the curly braces are proper and the commas wherever it is needed, those things are there. That is a pain. So instead of manually doing certain things, you can always depend on composer require command. So what does composer require command do is, composer require, this one, composer require vendor and package. So for you to install Drupal, XML sitemap module, all you would do is composer require Drupal. So the vendor for that module is Drupal/XML sitemap. When you hit enter, what composer will do is, it will first make an entry into your JSON file. Then it will download the module from Drupal.org's package repository, put it in your local as per your definition. Where you want to have the contrib module go to, it will just put the file there, like all those files. What does composer install does is, so composer install is the command to install all your dependencies. Like for example, here I was showing my pre-existing composer JSON file, right? I don't really need to do anything. All I need to do is, so I remove these, and if I just simply run composer install, it's going to install obeying whatever metadata available in my composer file. So if I say install module, this module, install that, do this, do that, whatever instruction is available within my metadata, the JSON file, it's going to install that. That is why, that is what composer install does. But whereas composer require is like composer . So it's for adding a new dependency or a new module into your application, you just need to do this.
Can you use a colon instead of a slash in the syntax the composer required? I haven't seen that somewhere.
No. That's for mentioning a version number. Uh-huh. That's in the end of it. So here what I'm doing is I'm just mentioned Drupal slash meta tag, meaning it's going to bring in the latest recommended version available in the package repository for my installation. But if I mention a specific version, mm-hmm. it's going to bring in that specific version. Okay. That is where you use colon.
Okay, thank you.
See, since I deleted all those and then I did composer require, it still downloads all the module. Because in my local, before I ran composer require, I deleted vendor, doc root, bin, all the three directories. That's why it's downloading every one of them. If I have not deleted and just simply ran composer Drupal slash meta tag, it would have just installed only one of it. So since I have included a bunch of that in my composer file, it's going to keep installing each and every one of them. And in between, you see these kind of things. Those are patching. That's also one of that we will be looking at today.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So the dependencies that you are having, if you're not removing the vendor or bin directory like you did now, and then you're just installing whatever is needed, like meta tag that you installed, just in case there is a version conflict, it will not resolve, right?
No, it will not automatically resolve. It will throw an error, mm-hmm. and it will ask you to pick the right version.
Okay.
So at times, what will happen is that you are using a particular module already in your application, and that uses a Symfony component, for example,
right.
like the HTTP foundation class or something, and it is already installed. Now you are installing another module which needs most latest version of HTTP foundation. So what will happen is that it will start throwing error. So you need to figure out which version you want to get it installed. First, you need to fix that dependency, then you need to install this.
So it's always recommended to remove the vendor or everything and
then? No, even if you remove it, there are chances you will get the error. It's because, that's what, as I said, you know, like if your core, not core, like meta tag, as an example, is there, and then you are using node unpublish or node API, something like that, a module. If you look at it in alphabetical order, your meta tag is there. So when your meta tag gets installed, it's going to install all its dependencies. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to node, there might be some problem which will throw an error. So now you need to choose which version of HTTP foundation to use. And if you look at your JSON file, you may have not even defined the HTTP foundation.
Right.
That's because you may not include it, but still you are getting an error. Why? Meta tag has a dependency, so meta tag installs it. Now, no, the other module which starts with N, that also has a dependency, it tries to install. That's how the conflict happens. To resolve it, you need to manually include that with a proper version, so both of it works. And then, similar to composer require, there is composer require dev. So, what is composer require dev is nothing but I have a require here. That's a big, bit long list. If you look at it, so this is require, and then there is a require dev. So the require dev is nothing but any package you need for development purpose, purely development purpose. You may not need that for your production server. So you need, yeah.
So is there any specific order that you have to do with these requires or?
No, not really. So here I have done one thing which actually, where is it? It puts all of them in an alphabetical order. In my configuration, I have configured that step.
Except for PHP.
Is it sort packages?
Sort package is true. So it's just going to sort every one of them by alphabetical order. So there is no specific need. If you don't use this, what will end up happening is that the order you install, it will just maintain that order. So the reason why I sort is, it's for my own benefit. You know, all the, it's alphabetical order, right? You can easily see what under what
I. Did you sort it yourself or does Composer?
No, Composer does it just by using this.
Oh, okay.
So you have this config, Composer will do that. And all these are optional, you know, like it doesn't get done automatically, you need to provide them. If you don't do PHP 7.3 like platform, as I was explaining earlier, it's going to install based on your local PHP version. If you have 7.1, it's just going to install everything from 7.1. But if I mention it, it's going to follow what I'm mentioning.
So if you install Drupal via Composer, so I'm just doing like Composer require Drupal recommended version, and then you just require all your modules, this file, the majority of it's going to be just created for you?
Yes.
So can you just talk about like what, after you do, if you, let's say you're starting clean, right? So Drupal, Composer require Drupal recommended project or Lightning, whatever distribution you want, require all your modules. What are the things that you do after that to modify this file and why?
See, first of all, you rightly said, like if you are going to start with Composer require Drupal/core, it's going to create that file for you.
Yeah.
So you don't need to run first Composer init, as I was showing. The file is already there. Now if you want to edit this file, some reasons, manually editing, not you know, dynamically. Some reasons is to add metadata like this, you know, like say I want to maintain the metadata of who is the project author, so like whoever is working on that information, or any of the project repository, or the additional configurations which I had in my you know, config section or extra section where I'm changing the path. Those kind of things I manually edited. If I don't have such needs, I don't need to edit any of them. You can just go with what you get vanilla. Yeah.
For patches, I've only been able to do them manually. Is there a way to apply?
Yes. Yes. So in fact, when I was just running a command a little while earlier, there were longer statements than shorter ones. Those were all patches. See, these are all patches.
And that, does that require the Composer patches plugin or whatever?
Yes, the additional Composer patch plugin is required to do that patching.
That's CWGIS.
See, this one.
Patches. Okay.
So it's another plugin you need to install with your project to do the patching. So you can do patching two ways. So one is using this and directly with the Composer help, and the other one is a different method. I do have that in my list of items to talk about. So Composer Dev, as I was explaining, you know, there is a lot of developer tools which you might need only in your local. Like for example, you know, OptimizeDB, Missing Module Fixer, those kind of modules, or even, you know, field name prefix remover. Those kind of things you need only in your development environment. You don't really need them in production. So those you can add it as a dev requirement. What will happen is that by default, Composer does install dev and non-dev together. If you don't want dev to be installed, you just need to mention --no dev. So it will not install any of the developer modules on that instance. In the past,
this is for the dev versions. If you actually do it on production, do you actually have to specify no dev or is that?
Yeah, no dev.
Yes, okay.
So in the past, it used to be the other way around. By default, Composer would never install dev version. You need to mention install dev version. Now it's the reverse. You need to mention that don't install dev version. And again, as you see, you know, like the devel module, right? It has no business sitting in a UAT environment or production environment. Yep.
The developer package is getting sold within the vendor folder as well?
Yeah, it will follow the same same folder structure. If it's a module, it will go to your whichever is your doc root and contrib, whatever you configure. And if it's a different package, like for example, bhat, that will go into vendor. Because that's not a Drupal module, right? The package type is not a Drupal module. It's a vendor package. So anything that's a vendor package will go into vendor folder. Anything is a Drupal module, it will go into the respective Drupal folder. See, that's why we mentioned these types here. Now type Drupal profile. So if it's a module, you mention, you know, Drupal-module. If a theme, Drupal-theme. So when a package gets installed, it is identified whether it's a pack like a vendor package or a Drupal package. Vendor in the sense, any non-Drupal related packages. So as I was mentioning Symfony, right? There are a lot of Symfony packages which will get installed with your D8 application when you try to install. All of them will reside within the vendor folder. All the Drupal modules or themes will go into your respective doc root, whether it's doc root or web or public HTML, whatever you're configuring, it will go into that. If you don't provide any of these information, by default, it will be created as web, because by default, it's web.
I have a question.
Yes.
So when you allow the dev, when you do require dev, the production side starts out as dev, so let's say you require it all. But then, what do you do then to prepare for production in this workflow?
Yeah, in production, when you run, like in this workflow, as I was mentioning, you are not going to have your bin, vendor, and doc root on your repository. Mm-hmm. On your production server or in your continuous integration server, you need to run the Composer install. So when the build is happening for production, you need to mention Composer install --- no dev.
Okay.
So it will not install any dev modules.
Question.
Yep.
So what's your recommended way for transferring your development system up to production?
So with Composer workflow, you are going to always install every time. You're not going to, like for example, if it's Acquia, you're not going to simply drag and drop. That's not better. It's always advisable to run your Composer install for that environment, wherever you are going to place it. Because your dev, in this case, you are going to have all your dev dependencies installed. But in your production, you are not going to have your dev dependencies, just as an example. So it's always better to run Composer install per environment to build your package for that environment.
And then transfer the SQL file.
So basically you would create a development version, you would do whatever you wanted to do to build the site, and then you would rerun it for the production.
Correct. So like that's why I was keep on mentioning about continuous integration. If you're going to have Jenkins-based installation, just as an example, like when you run in dev or stage environment, like QA environment, you can run Composer install, which will install all your developer packages also, if you want. And when you do the same thing in production, just do Composer install --- no dev. Mm-hmm. So it will not install that. And in case of Platform SH or Pantheon, which have an inbuilt support for Composer workflow, based on the environment it is running, like in platform SH, if it runs in the master version, it by default does that. Mm-hmm. Composer install --- no dev, so it will not install any dev packages in the production. Mm-hmm. And in fact, if you look at Pantheon or Platform SH, right? Even in their repository, you will not have bin, vendor, doc root, all these folders. Whereas in Acquia, you'll end up having it if you're not using pipeline. But if you are using pipeline again, you'll not have that there as well.
2 minutes?
Yeah.
Two minutes.
Oops. It's still behind. Okay. This is versioning. Most of you might be aware, if you are already using Drupal 8, you know what is the semantic versioning, right? How it works. It applies for even the regular modules or packages. It has semantic versioning. You can use them to specify which version you want. So this is just a simple example of how your semantic versioning works. You have multiple options to mention your packages. Either you can mention exact, wildcard, or within a range, stability constraint, or, all these options. So this is how you mention. Like, sometime back, someone was asking me, I've seen colon. So that's nothing but, what you see here, you can just mention that when giving your composer require Drupal /meta tag, colon, say, caret 8.8.0, which means it will install anything that matches this constraint. If you use tilde, it will install anything that matches this, but it will install the latest one. If you want exact version, you should just simply specify the number, exact number, so it will stop there. Yeah, we spoke about this, but I'm not sure if I have enough time to cover that. Now, for installing an existing Drupal site, like if you have a Drupal 8.7 site which you installed with a zip package, not Composer, the first thing you might notice is that your Composer file will reside inside web or docroot folder. So you need to move that out of web or docroot into the project root folder, meaning one level above to your repository folder. And then you need to manually, this is going to be pain, but you need to manually mention all of the modules and themes which you are using from community into your Composer, so that they all start working with your Composer workflow. There are some libraries available in GitHub, you can find it, which runs through your particular folder, put all of them into Composer JSON. Not this. Quickly, I'll talk through the patch since everyone was asking about it. See, we have one of the Composer patch plugin, which when we install, we can leverage Composer workflow itself to install patches for us in the Drupal project. Like, you want to patch, say, core, multiple patches for various reasons. So like this one, is for disabling update module. Like if update module is there used to be a notification up on the top, right? So using that patch, you can remove the notification. So the way how it is done is, it's patches and then your module or core, whatever you want it to be patched. And then this two things, first part is title, and then second part is colon and the patch URL. So patch file URL, you can see, it's a complete patch file URL from drupal.org, whichever patch you are going to use. And here the title, it's up to the user, like whoever is using it, based on their own benefit, they keep doing it. What I follow is that this is the issue ID, the specific issue in drupal.org. So picking up this number, you will be able to easily go to the issue queue. Drupal.org/node, this number, you will be in that issue. That's why that is there. And this is the title of the issue. Just for reference, if somebody is looking at the Composer JSON file, they understand, at least on a high level, they understand why this patch is included or what is that issue. And then the file directly.
When you're trying this out and you're just testing a patch, are you ordinarily like manually applying the patch, seeing if it works, and then once it works, recording it in Composer?
No, you can do it in the same way. Like, can do it with the Composer workflow, check it, and then if it doesn't work, you can remove it.
Okay, so you would apply the patch with Composer the very first time?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a way, and you can always do it manually also. There is no right or wrong step. When you put it in Composer, it's going to be there, always easily manageable. Mm-hmm. If you do it manually, and in case you forget to move it to JSON, you're going to lose that when you build next time.
If you remove it, what do you do at that point too?
You just need to delete this line, and when you just simply do Composer install next time, this will not be installed. Okay. Even if it is already patched, it will overwrite with the new version. So every time when we run Composer install, it's going to download the package from drupal.org or GitHub, wherever it is, and apply the patch on top of it.
So if you just want to update a module and you want to take out the patch, then just update, right?
Yes, you delete the patch, respective patch, like for example, extra link extra, right? If I don't want this patch anymore, I can just delete this line, and if I want to go to the next version, I can update it. And there is an option as well, like it's not always that we need to use patch from remote. You can use patches from your local as well. Like for example, see here, patches, total control, language, support, content, whatever it is I've written. So I have a folder called
down.
patches. And these are all custom patches which is created for the project. So you don't need to directly link a remote file. You can link a file that is remote to your repository. Even that can be patched. And the other option I have followed in this project is, you know, you can do patch post install also using patch command if it's available in your system. You know, like this one, the SAML patch. Because after Drupal, like after every files are downloaded, that is when I want this patch to be executed. So I use a separate command, like the patch command from command line to patch the file. Apart from these things, after you do Composer install in your local, this becomes your key file, like Composer lock. Composer JSON is your metadata. Composer lock is locking your project to a specific version. So in any Drupal project, when you use Composer workflow, you need to ensure Composer JSON and lock file is committed to your repository. The reason is, you might be testing in a version on your local. If you miss the lock file, next time the build happens on your server, it will download any version that matches the constraint. Like we saw that exact version, tilde, caret symbols and all, right? It matches multiple versions based on whatever you have given. What happens is that it can download anything that matches that constraint. So if you have a lock file, it will strictly adhere to that version which is there in your lock file. It will not go beyond that. It's almost like in your Composer JSON, you are mentioning a specific version. Any other questions? If not, we can wind up.
Do you regenerate your lock file then?
Yeah, that's only when we upgrade a module or something. If not, the lock file is always same. So the other time I remove the lock file is if I'm upgrading the total system from one version to the next, including all the modules and things like that, then I delete the Composer lock, do a fresh install.
And when you do the install, it regenerates the lock file?
Yes. So other option is you can do Composer upgrade or update command. So that is also going to do the same thing. If you do update, it will update your lock file. If you do upgrade, it will upgrade your modules and it will update your lock file also. So like D8.7 to 8.8, simply you run Drupal Composer upgrade Drupal/core.
Okay.
Then it will upgrade Drupal core and whatever is needed for that upgrade, it will upgrade all of them. Final step would be it will regenerate the lock file with the latest information.
Thank you.
No problem. Okay. Thanks.